David Goins, and if you're a visitor here, we want to welcome you. I'm the Director of Music and Worship, and you'll notice if you are a regular, it's a little bit different up here. We have a new preacher. Actually, he's not new. He's our former pastor, Reverend Jack Brewer, is filling in. Our day-to-day pastor, Dr. Phil Hill, and his beautiful wife are on a well-deserved vacation. I think they're on a cruise ship somewhere celebrating their anniversary, so amazing how you can get on that ship. You can't get any phone service. Man, that's awful, isn't it? But they'll be back next week. You'll also notice that the organ bench is a little bit vacant. Roy, likewise, is on a well-deserved little vacation this weekend. And ironically, last week I bragged on Ella Abney on her fantastic playing. What a wonderful congregation we have, full of talent, full of people who are willing to serve. And likewise, whenever Roy's gone, usually my mother-in-law, who sings in the choir, fills in. She called me yesterday and said, "I'm sick." And fret not. Right down the street is Miss Ray Hurley to step right in there. Isn't this a great church? This is a great church. I have the best job in the whole wide world. Don't have to worry about it. Likewise, we had that happen this morning upstairs. Somebody called and said, "I'm sick." Nah, we got it. We got it. And it's great. It's great to be in a house of the church that has such strong faith and such great membership. And we hope that if you are a visitor, that you'll consider this as a place to call home. You'll notice in your bulletin that we have several things going on. We're an active church. Wednesday evening, our activities go on. It's a great place and a great time to reconnect with one another. That's for my family. That's one of the three or four times we actually get to sit around the table and talk to each other and catch up. So join us if you would, if for no other reason, just to connect with your family and maybe your other congregation members. And then afterwards, we have some faith groups that break out. I'll be leading one this week on the architecture of worship. And you may think, well, that sounds boring. It's actually not. It's very good. And you'll see how the scriptures teach us to worship and why we worship the way we worship. It'll be maybe the first of many little parts or a series. So we'll see how it goes. But we'll be meeting after the dinner. Likewise, we have a knitting group that meets and fellowships with each other. And the youth meet over in the lighthouse. They have a great time and Bible study. And then afterwards, we have choir rehearsal. You're all invited, 7:15. Well, join us. Let us join our voices in unison to this call to worship. In the midst of a world where people hunger and thirst, come worship a God who feeds the hungry. In the midst of a world where people are abused and oppressed, come worship a God who calls for compassion and justice. In the midst of a world filled with wars and rumors of war, come worship a God who desires nothing but peace. In the midst of a world where love is not freely shown and forgiveness is hard to find, come worship a God whose grace and love know no end. Remain standing as we sing.
Thank you. It is a joy to be with you today, with old friends and people that I'm just now meeting. God bless you. Isn't it wonderful to be in His house and to know that we didn't have to come to invite God to meet us here? He's been with us all week long. And so let's honor Him as a time of prayer now. Shall we pray together? Almighty God, we are so glad that we don't have to come to a place, a building, designated as the house of God to meet you. We come here to honor you and to thank you for being with us every day, every moment of our lives. We're so appreciative, Lord, and we just in our world today to thank you that we didn't experience the snow and the ice and the terrible cold of some of our neighbors have, and we escaped that. But then when we remember that, we're also reminded that you love all of us, and that which blessed us, other people are suffering. So we're reminded today that all of us are under the love of God. And that's so good to know. And we want to thank you and praise you for that. It's good to be with this congregation, Lord. You know these people. You know their hearts. They've come today with joys. Some of them have come with some sadness. Some of them have come with some memories that are still very precious and sensitive in their hearts. And we want all of them to know that you love them, and whatever their need might be, the divine physician, the wonderful counselor, the Prince of Peace, the mighty God, the everlasting Father is there for us. And so we affirm that today. And Father, we thank you for sending your Son Jesus, because he's made all the difference in our lives. And so we want to honor and praise him. We confess to you that not always have we been your people living the way we should. But we're so glad to know that there's a renewal, forgiveness, a new start every time we gather together and come to you in prayer. So I pray today you bless our pastor and his wife, any others who may be traveling, those whose hearts are heavy, and may at the end of this service we find that we have been drawn closer to you and ready to serve you and give you praise and glory in all of our lives. I pray this in the precious name of Jesus, the one who taught us to pray the prayer we call the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. My privilege now to ask Dr. Arbor Kenter to join me here at the front. Before another Sunday comes, our mission team to Honduras will be on their way, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, all of them going at different times. And so it's a real treat to get a report before they go, because we'll really be praying for them these next couple of weeks. But we want Arba, who will be one of those on the team, to give you a little bit of brief background and let you know what's going on and make an appeal for our help.
Thank you, Jack. We've been going to Honduras now. This will be our 15th year. For 12 years, we went to a place called Fuerzas Unidas, and that was a very good experience for us, and we saw a lot of progress in that community. But unfortunately, we had to quit going there because of the gang activity made it not safe to continue going there. So we've been floundering for a couple years, but we have found a new place to go to. It's called Ciudad España, and that means City of Spain, and this is a place that was built a lot with the help of the country of Spain after Hurricane Mitch several years back. Anyway, this church there was formed by Jorge Rodriguez, who was the pastor of the Fuerzas Unidas Church when we first started going there. And the church was actually designed by Jim Burris from our church, who is an architect and who's constantly giving away his architect services. So it's kind of, even though it's new, it's also a kind of familiar. And it's going to be, I think, a wonderful experience. The pastor of the church is very excited about us coming. His wife is a medical doctor who works in Tegucigalpa downtown all during the week, and then comes on the weekends to the church. This is about 40 minutes outside of Tegucigalpa where we're going. And she comes and has a clinic on the weekends, so she's working pretty hard, and she'll be able to do follow-up on everybody that we see. So we'll be doing a medical and a dental clinic, and we'll be giving out eyeglasses and a lot of medications. And that comes to the fact that it's an expensive trip. All the people, all the missioners, the people who go, pay their own way for their flights, for their food, and their further housing while we're there. So the expense that we incur is for medications, for transporting us to and from the places we have to go, and for just a lot of logistics and that sort of thing. And a lot of times there's some building that goes on, and just meet whatever needs that we come across. So it turns out being about a $20,000 expense besides what it costs just for us to go ourselves. And we've had a race this year called the Frankfurt Frosty 5K, and that raised a considerable amount of money, but we're still a little short on our expenses, so we're hoping that somebody will feel led to help out and make a check out to the church and list the Honduras mission in the memo line to help us out. But I also want to point out that we've had a lot of help there from a lot of different people to keep this mission going. We're a very ecumenical mission. Right now, I think there's only like about 3 people from our church that are going on this trip, but we have people from the Catholic Church, from the Baptist Church, from Pentecostal Church, from any church that wants to come, basically. And we have a large group of different people that go. But we also have people from this church who support our mission. For instance, Cleveland White has been managing the finances for our mission for quite some time now, although he hasn't been to Honduras in several years. Marcy Broderson every year makes all the labels for all the medications, and that's thousands and thousands of labels that she makes for us. Just an hour ago, the SAGE class was counting out pills, the vitamin pills, to put in little baggies to give out to the people. So it's still very much a mission of this church. And so we very much appreciate anything that that you all do for us, and we appreciate particularly if you will pray for us while we're there, and for that matter, all the time. that communities in Honduras really need prayer all the time. So I think that's everything.
Thank you, Arba. Be assured we're going to pray for you all this week and next as you're there. Yeah. So we want to commission these folks, if you will, and there's a wonderful way of doing that with the bulletin. If you'll take the bulletin and turn, you'll find that there are words that I'll use for the commissioning, and then invite you to join me with the last part, which is your part in the prayer. Let's pray together, and would you be in thought as I read together this prayer to our Lord. Guiding and loving God, empower these people to be your hands and feet. Help them to glorify you by serving others, by their actions and words. Make them witnesses of your great love and your passion for rescuing your people. Protect them, teach them, and support them as they take this next step in their own journey to becoming the people you want them to be. Fill them with the Holy Spirit and enable them to do their task faithfully and joyfully. Bring them safely home, and then let their experience further enrich us, so that we too will glorify you by serving our community in the love of Christ. Heavenly Father, give them strength, wisdom, and love to work for you as they serve in Honduras. In Jesus' name, amen.
I can cheer somebody with a word or song, if I can show somebody he's traveling wrong, then my living shall not be in vain. Then my living shall
continue with our worship by standing and singing hymn number 571. And at that time, our children are invited to head that way towards Children's Church. Please stand as we sing hymn number 571.
I hope you were able to be with us last Sunday when we had the remembering our baptism. It was a special time for me because I remember that time when I was about 9 years of age and a pastor came to me and said, Jack, you've never been baptized. Well, I asked my folks because being a Methodist, I thought, you know, you should be baptized, but I learned my mom was Independent Church of Christ and they don't believe in child baptism. And so dad, being Methodist, gave in to mom, and so I, at 9 years of age, then experienced that wonderful, wonderful time. And then to be able to, every year or so, remember that was a very special thing. It reminded me so much that one of the fellows that was very important in Jesus' baptism was John the Baptist. He did the work. And as a pastor, I reflected on him this week, in fact, the last couple of weeks, about his life, what it must have been like to stand there on the Jordan River, water perhaps up to one's waist, and lift people down or drop them down into the water and bring them up or pour water over them or even sprinkle them with the water there as a time of baptism. As a young pastor, my very first immersion service was very interesting. Now, I'd done some sprinkling, as we call it, but this was my first time to ever dunk someone, as we did and said it and called it in those days. It was a lake. A lady came to me, and a member of the church who'd never been baptized, rather large lady, and she said, I'd like to be baptized by immersion, and I want you to come out to my farm where we have this lake. Really, it's a large pond. And I learned some things about immersion baptism. Number one, you make sure you know what's underneath the water when you start walking out. Because you can get into some really deep mud, and you finally make your way if you sand shoes, they come off. And then the second thing, which is even more important, when you help a person baptize them, don't baptize them out into the water. Baptize them back toward the shore, because when I finally stopped and got her up, we were up to our necks in the water. You learn those things. And number three, you learn when you're there, don't try to sing by the waterside. It just doesn't go over very well. But I thought about all those things and thought, John the Baptist, what a wonderful guy. And the purpose today of this sermon is to reflect about his life and learn some things from him. Now let's pray together. We're thankful, Lord, that we can talk about a man of faith, a man that we sometimes forget about, but his role was so important in starting the ministry of Jesus Christ that even extends to us today. Now may our thoughts bring to heart the hearts of our people good thoughts and change of life that we can go forth to serve you. In Jesus' name, amen. You know the story of John, but I'm going to tell it to you anyway, just to be, so you can recollect and be refreshed about it. John was born to parents. Father was a priest, Zachariah. Mom, Elizabeth, was a lady past childbearing age. And so although they had prayed for years for a child, nothing had happened till one day in the temple, Zachariah got the word, Zachariah, you're going to be a dad. And Zachariah, you're not going to talk until that baby's born. And so he was stricken, mum and mute, couldn't talk. And so when the baby was born, they said, don't you want to call him the son of Zachariah? He said, no, his name shall be John. He was able to speak again. John's mom was a probably first cousin to Mary, the mother of Jesus. And so John's mom became pregnant. 6 months later, Mary became pregnant. And so what do you do when you're a 14 or 15 year old girl, you're pregnant, and the community thinks you have no husband to do that because they were not yet married? You go talk to somebody. She went to talk to her cousin, another woman who was pregnant who would understand. And so the scripture tells us that when she showed up, the child that was in Elizabeth's womb recognized the holiness of the child in Mary's womb, and it said the baby jumped inside Elizabeth's womb. So these two boys were born 3 or 4 months apart. Did they know each other growing up? Probably did, because the communities in those days were pretty small. But anyway, John became the more well-known immediately. As a 30-year-old, he became a preacher. He wasn't a usual type of preacher with a congregation, a priest, or a rabbi. He was an evangelist. He came out of the wilderness where he had spent some time, dressed in either camel's hair clothes or even clothes that were woven from the hair from camels. He was eating locusts and wild honey. He came with, in my mind, I see him as a fellow who I wouldn't really want to spend a whole lot of time with him. I'd like him, but I wouldn't really want to live with him, because he told the truth in a very abrupt way. He was preaching out in the wilderness, and people started coming by droves. The common people loved him because he was telling the establishment what was wrong with them. Well, the establishment, King Herod, hated him, in fact, because he was talking about the moral indiscretions of marrying his brother's wife and even maybe committing murder in the process there. The Roman soldiers thought he was kind of neat because it was somebody new. They thought this was interesting, and they showed up to hear him. But the religious leaders, the Pharisees, were not at all happy with him. But they all came to hear him. And things were going great. He had great crowds. And then one day, after he'd baptized Jesus, his cousin, two guys showed up preaching at the Jordan River. Two preachers. One was John, and the other was Jesus. There's a story of what happened when those two preachers were preaching that day. And if you have your scripture and want to turn with me to John, it's in the second chapter, these verses from 22 and following. After this, Jesus and his disciples went into the Judean countryside. He spent some time there with them, and he baptized. And John was also baptizing at Enon near Salem, because water was abundant there. And people kept coming and were being baptized. And now, John, of course, hadn't been thrown into prison yet. Now, a discussion about purification arose between John's disciples and a Jew. They came to John and they said to him, Rabbi, the one who was with you across the Jordan, to whom you had testified, here he is baptizing, and everybody is going over to him. John answered, no one can receive anything except what has been given to him from heaven. Well, preachers are very sensitive people. And I don't know how I would have felt if somebody showed up in my territory and took all my members away. John had disciples. The very first time Jesus called his disciples, some of John's disciples went over and joined Jesus. And here they're out preaching together within, I guess, earshot almost of each other and baptizing in the Jordan River. And all the crowd all of a sudden starts moving over toward Jesus. How would you feel when someone comes into your life and takes your place? I admire this man after having spent some time with him this week because of the way he reacted. I've learned some things about my life, and I want to share those with you, and hopefully they'll be helpful to you. This is what John has taught me about how to live. Number one, he taught me that God had a purpose for his life. Before he was born, God had prophesied to the prophets for years there'd be somebody coming to tell you the story about the Messiah. They were always looking for someone, and John fit that bill. And when he came, his purpose, as he said, was not to take the place of Jesus, but he came to be the forerunner. He had a purpose that came from before he was born and even in his mother's womb, as I said. His purpose was one purpose, and that was to point people to Jesus. Bishop Will Wellerman, who is a Methodist bishop in the South, was pastor of the chapel at Duke University School of Theology for years, and he would speak to the graduates when they were ready to go out and become pastors. This is what he said one year at his graduation speech. I really resonated with this. He said, if you're going to graduate, you first have to get by the English department. If you're going to practice law, you got to pass the bar. If you want to go to medical school, you must survive organic chemistry. Likewise, if you want to know the joy of Christmas and worship the baby in Bethlehem, you must first get past John the Baptist in the desert. The word from John is repent, which means to turn your face around 180 degrees. John had a crucial place to play, and that was to point people to Jesus. And the lesson I learned from John in the first place is my life, am I pointing people to Jesus? He has a purpose for my life and yours. Now, I don't mean just a purpose that we're Christians and that we're living in this town and that we have this job or we have this family. I believe God is involved in all of that. But I think the overriding purpose for every Christian is to point people to Jesus. That bothers me. I wish that weren't true. I don't think it's fair. You mean that the people in this community that don't believe in Jesus or maybe are questioning, they'll look at me and say, that's what Jesus is like? When I'm driving down the street at the connector and somebody cuts in front of me, and they're going to look at me and, although you may not know, and say, that's what Jesus is like? When I go to the restaurant and the server there, it never seems to come, and they get my orders wrong and the bill isn't right, and what I say and think to that person is pointing to Jesus? When someone calls me up on the phone in the robocall or somebody wants something from me and I don't have time, and the way I respond to that person, is that pointing somebody to Jesus? When I'm in my home and I've got a sinus infection and my wife says something and I shoot back hard to her, is that pointing to Jesus? John, I wish you hadn't brought that lesson up. But isn't that the goal of every Christian? Should not that be the goal of every Christian? If we're like John, to point people to Jesus in the way we act. Not necessarily what I say, but sometimes it comes out. But just in the way I act. And so, John, you've taught me a lesson. How, when I live my life every day, can I remember the fact that those people out there, fairly or not, are looking at me if they know that I'm a Christian? Or maybe need to find out I'm a Christian because I act differently than they do. How about you? Does that resonate with your heart? And wherever you happen to be in your life, you have people that are looking around. They know who you are. Maybe they don't know you, but you have an opportunity to point them to Jesus. Maybe what you say, but more likely, the way you act. So I've learned my lesson. John, you've taught me. There is a purpose of life. Your purpose is the same as mine, to point people to Jesus. The second lesson I've learned is a little bit harder. Sometimes in life, you've got to play second fiddle. And that's what John was doing. I was telling them in the 8:30 service this morning, I learned what it meant to play second fiddle. In the early days of the symphony orchestras, there was always the first violinist, and probably true today, that the violin sets the stage for the whole orchestra. The concert master is often called, the first violinist is called a concert master. But there's always a second violin. In fact, there are rows of violins. You never think about them. It's always the first violinist that gets the honor. And so some people have to play second fiddle. I was reading in the gospel, or the words of Paul in the book of Romans, out of the Message, which is a paraphrase of the Bible, I thought it was interesting. But this is what he says. Paul says about how we're to live. Love from the center of who you are. Don't fake it. Run for dear life from evil. Hold on with dear life to good. Be good friends who love deeply and practice playing second fiddle. Even Paul agreed. That's the way some people have to be. It's hard to play second fiddle. Tonight, as you've already heard David mention, there's a service about Martin Luther King Jr. and his ministry and his witness, if you will, in the civil rights movement. We all know that name, probably worldwide, but do we know the name of Howard Thurman? Some of you may. Howard Thurman went to school with Martin Luther King Jr. at Millsaps College. A bit older, graduated first, a theologian, a professor, a pastor, one of the early leaders of the civil rights movement, friend of Martin Luther King Jr. Went on to become a professor at Boston School of Theology in Boston University. In fact, he went to India and met Mahatma Gandhi and learned about the nonviolent passive resistance that became a part of the civil rights movement. And when Martin Luther King Jr. came to Boston University to get his doctorate degree, who was his mentor? Howard Thurman. He taught him what Gandhi had taught him. His time came and left, and Martin Luther King Jr. became the leader that we know him to be. Howard Thurman's life sort of slipped into the background. We don't hear about him in the civil rights movement. He began to play second fiddle. But in his book, his classic book is called The Inward Journey, he talks about that, about having a certain purpose of life that God had given him, and that was okay. This is what he said. He said, the greatest journey we'll ever have is that inward journey. There's nothing more exhausting for a person than being aware constantly that life is lived at cross purposes. At each moment, the individual seemed to himself ever to be working against himself. What he longs for is the energy that comes from a concentration of his forces in a single direction, toward a single end, and his was to promote the work of civil rights. I admire that man, because sometimes we all have to play second fiddle. Sometimes there are times for us to step back and let others take the lead, and this is true in our church, true in our community. This is true when we encourage our young people and our young adults, but this is true at all times when we have people who guide us and we can guide them. So some of us, it's hard for us to learn how to play second fiddle. We always like to play the first violin. But John taught me by being able to step back and say, he's first. A wonderful lesson. The third lesson is a lot like that, because he taught me the best way to live in my Christian life. And he says it in John 3:30. Let me finish reading the scripture for today. For he says, he who has the bride is called the bridegroom. Now the friend of the bridegroom, the friends hearing, they rejoice at the bridegroom's voice. For this reason, my joy is full. He says, I'm happy. He must increase, but I must decrease. It's a beautiful way of putting what the spiritual life is all about. Having more of my God in my life and less of myself. And the wonderful part about that is when I do that, I find the fulfillment that Howard Thurman was trying to talk about, because so often I thought cross purposes what I want and what I feel God wants for me. And once I learned that lesson, he must increase, but I must decrease. I've learned the lesson of John the Baptist. So what is it for you in your life? Maybe what I've talked about today doesn't really resonate at all, but it seems to me that this man is saying these three things. My goal in life is to point people to Jesus. Sometimes I learn I have to be second fiddle, but the goal is I'm always going for Christ to be more in my life and me of less. I'm going to learn what it means to care for other people and show them who Christ is. That's a real challenge. And I appreciate this man who we talk very little about in the life of the church. Let's pray. Father, we're thankful that we have a man like this that was willing to be the forerunner, to step back when Jesus came preaching and baptizing, and all these men and women followed Jesus rather than John, and John gave it all up because he realized his purpose in life was to point toward Jesus. Lord, help us as Christians to learn how to do that in the way we act, the way we speak, and what we do in life. And we know this will be pleasing to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Arba has already mentioned to us the need for our Honduras mission for your donations, but also it's time to present our tithes and offerings. We'll ask our ushers and acolyte to come and serve us now.
Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we come today to find how to be subordinate, to increase our faith in you and to decrease ourselves. Please bless this tithe, honor it, welcome it into your kingdom, and may it do work to further that. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Exalting Hymn, hymn number 451, Be Thou My Vision.
John Dewey was an educator, philosopher, great teacher. One day, his teenage son was in the bathroom upstairs, and John heard the water running, and he went upstairs to find his son, who was a little bit scatterbrained, I guess you would say, mopping up water all over the bathroom, trying to keep it from going downstairs. And John said, "This is a good opportunity to teach this young man." He said, "Young man, have you learned any lesson from this? Have you decided what happened and what you could do about changing your life?" And his son said, "Dad, this isn't time to philosophize. It's time to mop." We've talked about John the Baptist and his purpose in life. Now it's time to go out and mop. It's time to go out and share the word of Christ in the way we live and what we say. May the peace of God be with you all. In the name of the Father, Son, and Spirit. Amen. God be with you till we meet again. Let us sing.